We continue our humble efforts towards inoculation, inoculating ourselves from insanity, actually. Insanity is very in vogue here. We call insanity the unrepentant spirit. Spirit that's unrepentant is functioning, has a very insane interpretation going on. And we certainly do not want to get caught up in that. We need to inoculate ourselves from that. So we're going through this, we're in phase four now, which is very intense inoculation. Now, it's very simple what's going on here, actually. If you can just get this picture of simplicity. Nothing arises without our desire to experience it. Now, we had a desire to be the creators of creation and not God. We wanted to be the prime creators. So what we did was we wanted an interpretation of reality that interprets reality different than what it is, actually, different. So we can say, this is our creation, you see? So that we thought the power of creation, we could do it through just simply misinterpreting reality, misinterpreting what it is, and then claiming, this is what it is, and we did it. You know, as if misinterpretation is creation. So when we had this desire to misinterpret reality, we had an appearancing and an appearancing arise that showed this misinterpretation as plausible. This plausibility, when we look at the appearancing that justifies our misinterpretation, our desire to misinterpret, we say, oh, you see, it's true. Because look, we're looking right at it right now. It's like a hallucination. It's kind of like we want to hallucinate that there's a tree and there's a space with open space, and we say, no, it's not an open space. There's a tree there. And we hallucinate a tree, and then we say, oh, you see, there is a tree there. That's why I thought there was a tree there. So what we do is first we desire something, then the appearance arises, and then what we did was then we see the appearance, and then we say, oh, there was a tree there all along. I just wasn't seeing it. So I'm not hallucinating. And we think, well, not seeing it there was the hallucination, you see. So this is the trick that we've done. It's very simple, very simple. It gives you a simple analogy. Let's say we're looking out on a clear, spaciousness and landscape. And this it symbolizes reality. We say, I don't want reality to be the way it is. I want to change it. So we hallucinate a forest, let's say. We hallucinate a forest. Our desire to change this flat plane, so to speak. We say, I don't want that. I want to change it. I want the change to be reality, the base of reality, instead of an appearance. So we hallucinate a forest, and then we look at the forest and we say, oh wow, look at that forest. There is a forest here. And then instead of saying I'm hallucinating a forest out of my desire to change reality, we say, oh, you know, this forest has been there all along, and it was this flat plane that must have been the hallucination. I must have been hallucinating this flat plane all along, and the forest has always been there. That's reality. So it's just this very simple, we hallucinate and then we claim that what we're hallucinating actually has been there all along, and it was prior to what we were seeing prior to the hallucination actually is the hallucination, and that was never there. Very simple, isn't it? This is the whole basis of delusion. The entire basis is right there. We desire to see reality in a way that it's not. We want to change it. We want to say that we're the prime creators. How can we experience being prime creators unless we change reality? We want to think we have the power to alter the very nature of reality. Therefore, we must be God, Prime Creator. So how do we do that? Through hallucination. Hallucination is the arising of appearances wherein we believe that what we're seeing as an appearance has always been there as the ground of being. And the ground of being that we previously were experiencing must be the hallucination. And as it was only temporary and ephemeral. So we flip-flop between ground of being and appearances. We take the appearances to be the ground of being and the ground of being to be the appearance. It's that simple. If you can just say, okay, full stop, don't struggle with it. Now obviously, since this is the case, we don't need to do anything with the hallucination. We're hallucinating a forest. All we need to do is say, oh, this forest is a hallucination. Okay, just an appearance, that's all. The ground of being is still there. I was just having appearances arise and then wanting to take the appearance as if it had always been there. The more we can rest in simplicity, the easier it gets for us. The more we can be inoculated from the rabidity, the rabidness of insanity. Insanity is very rabid. Insanity insists that what arises as mere appearance is actually the very nature, the very ground of being. And that the very nature and ground of being is an hallucination, is just an appearance arising, all right, as temporary. For instance, we believe that this forest we're seeing is all crystallized. Appearance is all crystallized. And this is then set in time, space, process, form. It's actually form. All right, and we say, oh, that's real. And then uncrystallized reality, you say, oh, that's just a hallucination. That everything eventually subsides back into crystallization, you see. Instead of realizing that reality is total emptiness, spaciousness, non-crystallizing, non-congealingness, and that all appearance rises and dissolves as that emptiness, mere appearance, it never crystallizes. We reverse the situation entirely in our belief, in our desire to change reality. Now this teaching comes from Jesus and the Holy Spirit, and it gives the overall context to all teachings. For instance, we have this great teaching by Longchenpa about spaciousness, which shows us, which really informs us of how to release this delusion. Release in the now, simultaneous, coincident release of all appearance without trying to manipulate appearances as if, well, there's part of this forest is dark and part of this forest is light, part of this forest is real, part of the forest is not real, it's delusion. See, this is how we keep ourselves deluded. So Longchenpa is an absolute genius about this and has the supreme clarity and ability to convey it, evoke it in the structure of words and sentences, and the evocation is very clear there. So this is very, very helpful. But the overall context, for me, starts with this explanation, this simple explanation, which I have gotten through working with Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit, and explain this very simple trick we've tried to play on ourselves. that what we're seeing as hallucination is real, and what we were seeing prior to that, what we were aware of prior to that, is hallucination. You see, now when we take hallucination to be real, okay, and we try to get clever with it, when we feel this pull back to recognizing it's not real, in our spiritual pride we realize, wait a minute, if we follow this pull, this self, everything self-released in the now, spontaneously self-released in the now, as Longchenpa points out, if we do that, we'll realize we're not prime creator. So our pride and cleverness jumps in and says, hey, wait a minute. So we're looking at this forest that we're hallucinating, and we say, hey, you know, the problem is that part of this forest is like really dark, right? And over there in the forest is more spacious and light in the forest. So what we really want need to do is sort of thin out this that dark area of the forest. We need to thin it out. We need to bring some more light into the dark area of the forest. We need to enlighten the forest. We need to lighten it up some a bit. This is called spiritual dualism. Spiritual dualism is how we bind ourselves to this, believing this hallucination is real and that reality is a hallucination. And so it is spiritual dualism that these great teachers like Longchenpa help us with. Okay, that evoke. How do we gradually receive? Oh, we allow the whole forest to be released simultaneously in the now, right as it is, without any motion, without anything taking place. That frees us from the spiritual dualism. Spiritual dualism is very busy trying to bring light to darkness, the light part of the forest to the dark part of the forest. And they say, we need to send people from the area of the forest that's got a lot of light in it over to the area of the forest that's kind of dark. We need to explain to them how much better it is to have this forest that has light, more light in it. And, okay, this is delusion. This is the trick of spiritual pride that has us working on light and dark, good and bad. This is what binds us to delusion. We're not doing anything about realizing what we did. We're not repenting at all. Spiritual dualism has not repented at all. And much of the teaching in this world has always been spiritual dualism. So what Longchenpa does, he's super, super aware of this. He points out this fact in a brilliantly clear way. And you just hear this. And it's tough to hear because we have been caught up in spiritual dualism, for sure. We have these beings come into the world who seem to be full of light and bliss and positivity. They say, you know, we got to get to work on this and bringing the truth to the world. And it seems really wonderful rhetorically. Yeah, we're bringing light to the darkness and all that stuff. This is delusion. This is a trap. This is pride. This is spiritual pride. And the world is saturated with spiritual dualism. And we're intrigued by it. We're thinking, oh, there's something that's dark. You know, who cares about a hallucination that's dark or a hallucination that's light? The point of it is that it's a hallucination. So we may be hallucinating some bright light and claiming this hallucination of bright light is reality and what we were seeing before is mere appearance. This is the same mistake as hallucinating darkness. It's the same mistake. But what we're doing is we're claiming it's not the same mistake. We're claiming that hallucination of light is somehow fundamentally different than a hallucination of darkness. And that hallucination of light dispelling hallucination of darkness is somehow liberation. No, it's merely an attempt to hang on to hallucination. Hallucination meaning we don't see that our desire is for the hallucination to be real. So, the attempt to get rid of the forest, Longchenpa points out, that is still hallucination. Because what it's really saying is, well, okay, let me hallucinate something different. the forest. Yeah, let's get rid of the forest. That is still spiritual dualism. What Longchenpa is pointing out is, No, merely see the forest as mere appearance arising from your desire for experiencing, which is all the form of emptiness, the form of spaciousness, all supersaturated, equally supersaturated with pure spaciousness, with pristine self-sprung awareness. Just see it as that. See, don't try and manipulate the dream. Simply, and don't try to get rid of all the forms of the dream arise. Simply see it as an arising of appearing from your desire, instead of a hallucination. You know, you see, this is the essence of it. So let's not struggle with it. Hallucination doesn't mean so much to see something that's not there. It means to see appearance as if it did not arise as our desire for appearance, as if it's not appearance, as if it's fundamentally the uncreated, undesired base of reality, you see. And that the fundamental base of reality, the uncreated pure spaciousness, is somehow just an appearance that subsides back into this appearance. That's hallucination. But desiring experiencing to arise, that's the natural functioning of reality. We just have to repent from our desire to twist that into a hallucination, to believe it's a hallucination, and then believe the hallucination is real. So we hallucinate a forest. What we're desiring is for an appearance to arise. Fine. So we don't compound the mistake by saying, I've got to get rid of that forest. It's the forest that's wrong. It's not the forest that's wrong. Appearances are not wrong. There are no wrong appearances. It's our desire in how we interpret these appearances that is the mistake we're making. Which is why we term the hallucination. Hallucination is a term which means we are unaware that what we're seeing is merely an appearance that we're seeing. We think that we are being seen by it, that we're the appearance, and that we're being given rise to by the appearance that we're seeing. You see, as if reality were a mere appearance arising from the appearance that we're seeing. That's what hallucination is talking about. Don't struggle with this, full stop. Just full stop it. Don't struggle. Now, if to the extent that you're able to not struggle with this is the discipline, then to that extent you know that you have made a lot of progress, for sure. That you can stay with it. Don't detach from it. Don't disassociate. But don't struggle. Now you feel a burn, right? Of course, because this is the central issue of the entire situation. This is the central issue, is to hallucinate or not to hallucinate, to understand, recognize what is the nature of hallucination actually, is the central issue. And of course, we're going to have fear around this. It's not easy to talk about this. This is the best I've ever been able to talk about it. Thanks to the work I'm doing, thanks to the clarification, thanks to the context that Jesus Christ has given, and thanks to the very specific, tremendous clarity of Longjumpa on releasing this. Essentially, release from hallucination is what he's talking about. Thanks to that, I'm able to now explain this. And you're probably hearing this in this way, in this particular way, for the first time. It's a wow feeling. And so you're used to the wow feeling. You say, oh, this is the wow feeling. Okay, I don't need to struggle with that. I just need to let it sit there and do its work. It's like putting Alka-Seltzer, you know, tab of Alka-Seltzer in a, I don't know if people still use that, in a water, and it's fizzy, 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 fizzy. Just once you drop it in the water, just let it fizz. It will all fizz away. After a while, you look and there's no more tablet there. It's all evanescent. It all evanesced away. So explanations are like dropping a tablet of Alka-Seltzer. Just fizz, 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 fizz. And as it's fizzing, you're not worrying about all the bubbles and counting them, trying to calculate, you know, how many bubbles are arising, and where exactly the bubbles are arising. All this, you know, calculation, mental concatenation, calculation. You just let it fizz. So you're just not struggling with calculation. This is the secret. This is the secret. Now, we're being taught that if we don't calculate, we're stupid. You see, this is the problem with this modern age, the age of calculation. Computers, computation. Education is indoctrinating everyone in that they must account and calculate. And for whatever it is, this is their role, this is their purpose. It's just the opposite. There's no need to account whatsoever. And if we get caught up in that, for sure, we're going to remain in this delusion of hallucination. This is why this is the end of the age. This is the time right now where we're going to go one way or the other. But don't struggle with that either. Do not struggle. Even in that explanation, don't struggle with any explanation. Don't try to meditate on it. Don't try to figure it out. As Longchenpa says, don't put in your intellect. Don't figure it out. Don't analyze. Don't struggle with it. And don't struggle to try and turn it into release either. As soon as you get into struggle, you're in spiritual duality. Because the point is everything, we release the hallucination, the principle of hallucination, all as one. All as one. That's why it's called the vision of oneness. The release from hallucination is called the vision of oneness. All as one. We're not trying to manipulate the hallucination and get rid of the appearancing. We're not trying to change the appearancing of it at all. We're trying to let go of the motive behind it, you see. Now, this appearancing that we're desiring lends itself to this position of hallucination, because it does seem appear to be crystallized, like form. It does seem to be processed, you see. So it's a very potent kind of appearance that seems to justify hallucination, for sure, for sure. And therein lies the difficulty, therein lies the burn, because we say, wow, it's such a great, this appearance is so amazing. It's certainly plausible to infer that this is the ground of being, right? So we're honoring our creativity. We're saying, wow, look how creative we can be. That's really quite amazing. Yes, it is. But what we're getting to is, do not struggle. And do not even struggle with the struggling. With the overcoming, the seeming overcoming that is always happening here. The light enlightening the dark, and the dark giving way to the light, as if, you know, something's actually happening other than mere appearance. There is no meaning in all this changing of appearance whatsoever. And don't struggle with that. Fundamentally, the hearing is one of not struggling with what is being heard, but simply hearing it, because it's all speaking to simply a position that we're arbitrarily holding on to. This position of what we call hallucination. So we don't want to compound what we're saying. We don't want all this compoundment taking place. We want to feel like that we're relaxing into the complete simplicity of simply releasing this position, this standpoint that we're taking, this viewpoint. Reality doesn't have any viewpoint. There is no viewpoint of reality. You cannot say that I have a viewpoint of on reality. No one can have a viewpoint on reality. That's hallucination. Even you cannot say I have an enlightened viewpoint on reality. No such thing. That's spiritual duality. I say I have a very enlightened viewpoint. That's total delusion. That's hallucination. That's spiritual duality. Reality is simply our desiring for experiencing, and then the arising, the appearancing of a, you know, to give us this experiencing. There's no need for any viewpoint. It's just the functioning of reality. There's no viewpoint on reality. There's only the functioning of reality as it is. Say there's a viewpoint is really hallucination, the stance of a hallucinator, of insisting that we're hallucinating instead of just this is mere appearance. And again, we believe that this appearance, when we insist on hallucinating, that the appearance that we're seeing, we believe that the experiencer is a hallucination or a mere appearance, arising of an appearance from the appearance, that appearance. That it's the appearance is desiring for the experiencer to arise as an appearance. So we've got it backwards, upside down and backwards. Even though appearance arises spontaneously, as Longchamp says, self-sprung awareness in the now, meaning coincident arising, instantaneous, manifesting instantaneously. There's no gap of time, spontaneously in the now. Even so, appearance does not arise without the desire of the experiencer for it to arise. See, that's prior. That's the priorness. When we say the prime creator, we're an extension of the prime creator, meaning the experiencer and the will and desire to experience, for experiencing. That is the fundamental ground of reality. And appearancing cannot arise if it weren't for this fundamental nature of reality. No desire for appearancing, no appearancing could possibly arise. So even though the arising is instantaneously, there's no gap. The will for the arising is not coming from the appearance. It's not invested in the appearance, actually. So what we did is we tried to believe that the will for arising is invested in the appearance itself, and that the experiencer, the will of the experiencer, is actually arising from the will of the appearance. This is, again, backwards, upside down and backwards. Don't struggle. Don't struggle. Don't struggle. Don't struggle. Let me see. Let me see if I can pull up some specific admonitions here. I think. Okay. Yeah. Here we go. Let me just read something to help you with this struggling issue as we're dealing with this hallucination issue. In short, all conscious sensory perception and all that is unconscious or transcendent, meaning all appearance or lack of appearance, everything is already released in the spaciousness of the now. So any attempt to liberate anything anew is superfluous. Okay? In short, all conscious sensory perception and all that is unconscious or transcendent, everything is already released in the spaciousness of the now. So any attempt to liberate anything anew is superfluous. So, you know, here's the admonitions. When we hear this, he's talking about don't struggle, okay? It is pointless to try and make effort towards release. So don't try. Don't try. Don't struggle and strive in practice. Don't seek. Don't seek. Don't seek intellectual truth. Don't meditate. Don't meditate. Don't contrive meditation. Don't analyze. Don't analyze. Don't analyze in or after an event. Don't practice. Don't practice. Don't practice the upshot of hope and fear. Don't reject. Don't reject. Don't reject emotional karma. Don't believe, don't believe, don't believe in righteous religion. Don't trap yourself, don't trap yourself, don't cage your mind. Okay. So this is what he's speaking of, is what we say is full stop in the now, full stop in the burn. So when we're experiencing this burn, which really is totally based on we're working on our continuity fear, because we've repented and we've realized we've been hallucinating, taking the position of hallucination, and we're used to thinking that we are actually the experiencer is actually arising from the will of the appearing, you see, backwards, and we feel if we see appearance as mere appearance, that we'll cease to exist. We'll cease to exist, and we know we won't, but we have this, you know, fear, like, wow. So we're nervous. So what we have to do is do not react to this nervousness, just full stop in the nervousness. So we don't try. We don't seek, we don't meditate, we don't analyze, we don't reject, we don't believe, we don't trap ourselves. This is all just full stop in the now. Full stop in the now. We understand this is simply an ordeal here. An ordeal based on this long, long extended effort to believe in hallucination. To take the stance of hallucination, to take the stance of a hallucinator rather than an experiencer. There's a big difference between the stance of a hallucinator and an experiencer. See, we think that we're being experienced by nature, by this appearance, that we're merely arising from nature, from appearance. We're an appearance of nature. We believe that's a stance of hallucination. It's what it is nature. What we see as nature is merely an appearance arising from our spiritual will and desire. But it's an appearance that is designed to trick us and deceive us into thinking that we're arising from nature, you see? And so we think, wow, if I see it the right way, will I exist? Well, of course. What Longchenpa's pointing out is, again, to read this brilliance. In short, all conscious sensory perception and all that is unconscious or transcendent, everything is already released in the spaciousness of the now. So any attempt to liberate anything anew is superfluous. Any attempt to liberate anything anew. See, spiritual duality is all about trying to liberate something. This perpetuates the delusion. It perpetuates the delusion. It's our stance of wanting to be an hallucinator that we need to be released, that we need to allow, release, as it were, repent from. Say, okay, no, I'm going to change what I desire. I no longer desire to be greater than God, be the creator of reality. We thought we could say, no, we're the creator of reality, spirit. All right, so this is this little game we've been playing, but it's a game of self-deception. And we're very talented at that because of the appearancing that we can desire is so convincing. So convincing. Right? Very convincing. But, Longchenpa points out, nothing ever strays, no appearance ever strays an iota from the pure spaciousness that it is. Pure spaciousness of the now, the pure spaciousness of the now, the pristine, non-conceptual spaciousness of the now, of the absolute spontaneity of desire and appearance being coincided. Okay, coincided means arising at the same, coincided means at the same moment. That means now. There's no causal concatenation, no causal process at all. In appearance. There's no causal process at all in appearance, in terms of time, time-space. None. That's why I say it's self-sprung spontaneity in the pure spaciousness of now. Now is this unfathomably smoothed-outness in which there is no time or causation at all, time-based causation at all. It's the will and desire to experience, and the simultaneous arising. The words here, spontaneous self-sprung in the now, spontaneously self-sprung. In other words, it's not being sprung from something other than this now, this self-sprung in the now, which means our will, our desire, and the appearancing of what we want to experience is simultaneous, concurrent, coincident, concurrent, coincident, not some gap of a moment. There's no momentary gap where we have a desire to experiencing and the experiencing says, I'm not quite ready yet, or what? Or wait a minute. There's no wait a minuteness. There's no wait a minuteness. So there's never been anything arise that isn't this causeless, timelessly causeless appearancing. It's already released in the now. I mean, it's already abiding in the now. The term released, yes. There's nowhere for it to be other than in the now. So release, arising, subsiding, it's all the same. There's no, it's not straying. There's no appearance arising is not straying from the desire. One iota, there is no straying whatsoever. So, again, don't struggle, don't try, don't analyze what they're saying. Don't try, don't seek, don't meditate, don't analyze, don't reject, don't believe, don't trap yourself, right? Don't analyze, try, seek, reject. Nothing has to happen to the appearance. Nothing has to happen. It's our stance of a hallucinator that is the issue. We need to repent of that stance. This is the whole point of the entire teachings of salvation, is repent. You cannot be saved unless you repent. The spiritual dualists have not repented. They're trying to be very, very cleverly saying, you know, we can have our cake and eat it too. We can maintain the stance of a hallucinator and yet still be happy, fulfilled, and enlightened. It's relativistic enlightenment, and we can be very tricky about that for sure. Absolutely. We can fill in all the words, okay, easily. And we can even seem to be blissful and happy for a while. For a while. Through contrast. And we've worked on many, many tricky ways to manipulate the appearances and make it seem that we can be God of this realm, so to speak, meaning blissfully, effortlessly, blissfully happy. But it doesn't really turn out that way, because actually the effort is still there, even though it may be subtle. And the demands for energy and support and enslavement, everything, it's all still there. They say, well, I need you to help me to get rid of this darkness. I need you to give me your energy because I'm dissipating, you know, this. That's all spiritual dualism. It's delusion. It's Longchamp says, it's a perverse intellect. It's the conceit of the devil. So devilish conceit, as he makes the words he's used. Do I trust Longchamp? I do, having met him in spirit. Totally humble, totally non-boastful. You would never know that he's a true realizer at all if you met him. He's not making any claims at all. I simply asked him some questions, a little dialogue, and I said, I can tell. I said, wow. Not feeling a need to prove anything, not boasting, like the dualistic spiritual teachers, you know, very boastful, very this. You can tell. No, you just you would walk right past them and would not know anything about it. Just a simple, unprepossessing appearance. Knowing appearance to be mere appearance, knowing it's already self-released in the now, knowing that everything is already released in the spaciousness of the now, knowing that everything is already released in the spaciousness of the now, there's just this effortless calm and knowing. And you can pick up on this. I picked up on it. I had no idea who it was. No idea. Just someone. And I just picked up and said, hey, let me ask you a few things. And two questions. And his answers are just, yeah. And just the way that he just gave the answers, and that was it. It's just not, everything is already self-released in the now. There's no braggadocio, no, hey, I'm a great teacher-ness. hey, I'm enlightened this. Nothing like that. Because as he says, the enlightenment is self-released in the now. He goes into this, he has this long, let us go through this. This is very intense. It's called release. It's called release. This is a very intense, and don't struggle with it. Do not struggle with this. But this is something that can cause, I struggle with this. When I'm reading it, I start to struggle. But this is a very, very intense practice. So we say, don't try, don't seek, don't analyze, don't meditate, don't practice, don't reject, don't believe, don't trap yourself. Someone maybe is calling me. One moment. Let me see. I hear a voice calling. It's calling. Okay. Let us try this. If you want to know what an intense non-dual practice really is, this is it. All experience is released here and now in luminous mind. An unreleased event is impossible. Samsara is released in the now, liberated as alpha purity, as fundamental, essential purity, clear purity. Nirvana is released in the now, liberated as spontaneous perfection. Appearances are released in the now, liberated in their baselessness. Life is released in the now, liberated in its luminous heart. Mental elaboration is released in the now, liberated in its limitlessness. Formlessness is released in the now, liberated as pure potential. Pleasure is released in the now, liberated in its equalized reality. Suffering is released in the now, liberated in the ubiquitous basic expanse. Dispassion is released in the now, liberated in the sky-like Dharmakaya. Purity is released in the now, liberated in its empty authenticity. Impurity is released in the now, liberated in supreme spacious freedom. The levels and paths are released in the now, liberated in the absence of creative and fulfillment stages. View and meditation are released in the now, liberated in non-discrimination. Conduct is released in the now, liberated in the all good. The goal is released in the now, liberated in the absence of hope and fear. Samayas, her secrets, are released in the now, liberated in the supreme reality. Recitation is released in the now, liberated in nonverbal expression. Contemplation is released in the now, liberated in the absence of a field of thought. Affirmation and negation are released in the now, liberated in the middle way. Dogmatic belief is released in the now, liberated in absence of any ground. Authenticity is released in the now, liberated in absence of any preconception. Inauthenticity is released in the now, liberated in non-critical bias. Karma is released in the now, liberated in its boundless transparency. Afflictive emotion is released in the now, liberated in thorough disinterest. Karmic proclivity is released in the now, liberated in its groundlessness. Karmic result is released in the now, liberated in the discontinuity of experience. Anecdotal method is already released, liberated in self-sufficiency. Liberated in the vast sky-like expanse of non-dual give and take, catharsis is released in the now. Liberated in non-repression, repression is released in the now. Liberated in sky-like freedom, hanging loosely is released in the now. Liberated by the absence of anything to relax, resting freely is released in the now. Liberated by the absence of anything brought to rest. Liberated by the absence of anything brought to rest. And then he goes on, as we have just read before, in short, all conscious sensory perception and all that is unconscious or transcendent, everything is already released in the spaciousness of the now. So any attempt to liberate anything anew is superfluous. Resting freely is released in the now, liberated by the absence of anything brought to rest. This is essential non-dual clarity. It is pointless to try and make effort toward release. So don't try, don't seek, don't meditate, don't analyze, don't practice, don't reject, don't believe, don't trap yourself. So we don't struggle. We simply full stop in the now, full stop in the burn. Now, it may be uncomfortable. Full stop in the burn is uncomfortable, sure. But if you could see in hindsight the incredible amount of misery you're saving yourself from full stop in the burn, you would embrace it every moment of the day. Say, please more, this is great, this is great. It's like a minuscule amount of discomfort compared to a vast ocean of hideous suffering that comes from spiritual dualism. Spiritual dualism actually is the primary perspective on this hallucinatory story stance has, because it says that it can bring something to rest, as Longchenpa says, in the absence, liberated by the absence of anything brought to rest. Okay. Whereas spiritual dualism says, oh, I can bring something to rest. I can release something. I can liberate something. I can liberate some aspect of this appearance, or even any of this appearance. That comes primary with the hallucination, desire to take the stance of hallucination. And then this works its way down into all sorts of confusion that ultimately end up with the situation we've been struggling with, this like delusional belief system that we have, and we seem so stupid. And then as we try to work our way back up, we work our way back and see these so-called higher levels of spirituality. But what we're really seeing is this spiritual dualism that actually worked its way down into this dull, knuckleheadness that we have been experiencing, right? Thinking that this is our mind, a real stupidity. If you look at most in this world, they're suffering with abject stupidity. This is all the workings of spiritual dualism that seem to be high and mighty, but are not. the stupidity is inherent within it. This dullness, the stupidity, is all one with this supposed high and mighty spiritual dualism that is just merely supporting the desire to take the stance of hallucination. So this type of teaching here by Longchenpa is showing us the overall clarity as one, the whole situation. Oh, there's nothing that needs to be brought to rest. This is it, right? There's nothing that needs to be brought to rest. Everything is already self-released. experience is released in the now of luminous mind. An unreleased event is impossible. So everything is inherently self-released in the now. It's not that it arose and then was released. It's inherently from its very coincident arising. It never strays one iota from being self-released in the now. Self-released in the now. Meaning there's no cause of the release. It is self-released in the now. Inherently so. In fact, it never strayed a bit, so you can say that, as he does with all this release, everything is released in the absence of a need to bring anything to rest. It is inherently so. We're just using words, so we think something's happened. But we're seeing clearly what he's pointing to. Remember, we're so used to spiritual dualism and the words that arise from spiritual dualism as confusion, really, as contrast to, so we don't see spiritual dualism for what it is. We don't recognize hallucination for what it is. So words are being used, but the essence that the words are pointing to, we get this flavor, this essence, I feel what's being pointed to. And so he goes through this whole list. We keep thinking, okay, well, yeah, it's purity that we need. He says purity is released in the now, liberated in its empty authenticity. Liberated, it is released in the now. Self-purity is self-released in the now, liberated in its own authentic authenticity. Liberated in its empty authenticity. Liberated in its empty authenticity. Purity is self-released in the now, liberated in its empty authenticity. Liberated in its empty authenticity. And even resting freely is released. Resting freely is released in the now, liberated by the absence of anything brought to rest. So what he's doing here is he's saying there is no concept of it. Okay. So don't get stuck on a concept of purity. That concept too is released in its self-released in the inherent empty authenticity, in its inherent empty authenticity. Liberated in its empty authenticity. Liberated in its empty authenticity. You see. There's like a bridge here. There's like a bridge. It's the fourth phase bridge. So we don't want a concept of resting freely and easily. This is where spiritual dualists get caught. He's caught them right here. I mean, he nailed them. And we have those who have been in this world who are spiritual dualists. They're like the apex of spiritual dualism before it got, you know, precipitated down into all this, you know, insanity. Except that was actually, it's all one. It's all inherent within it. But it is possible to put on the act, put on a pretension of being this, you know, the high and mighty, the top of spiritual dualism. But, and then they try to rest freely and hang loosely as he talks, Longchenpa. So what he does is, hanging loosely is released in the now, liberated by the absence of anything to relax. Resting freely is released in the now, liberated by the absence of anything brought to rest. So, when I met Longchenpa, there was no appearance that he's hanging loosely or resting freely. No, it wasn't like that. Those two were released in the now, in the absence of anything to bring to rest. In the absence of anything brought to rest. In the absence of anything brought to rest. There's nothing brought to rest. So the spiritual dualist can appear to be hanging loosely. You know, the naked adept, he's really just like hanging out. Just, I'm so hanging out, so free, so loose and everything. And they say, look what I've brought to rest. Look what I'm bringing to rest. Look what I'm bringing to rest. No, that's spiritual dualism. That's only trying to abide at the so-called pinnacle of spiritual dualism. Okay. Where it seems like release. You think you are the light that can literally release from all the stupidity we can, you know. No, that's a contrivance. So you can feel the difference between this contrived hanging loosely, resting freely, thinking that I've released, brought all this stuff to rest. And the Longchenpa, who realizes in the total absence of anything brought to rest, it's just like, it's different. There's no sense of contrivance. I didn't feel any sense of contrivance with him. Big difference. He wasn't drawing any attention to himself. Like, hey, everybody, look how hanging loose I am. Look how loose I'm hanging. Look how I'm hanging loose. And look how much I'm resting in this ease and comfort and rest. Look at that. Watch me. None of that whatsoever. So this is someone who has been around the whole spiritual scene and seen through it entirely. And all of the traps of spiritual dualism that arise and are still arising, you know, is truly been, truly has recognized. Self-released in the now. There's no experience. It's impossible for an experience to rise. It is impossible. An unreleased event is impossible. An unreleased event is impossible. An unreleased event is impossible. An unreleased appearance is possible. But he goes even further. Event, you see, this is even more potent. Because we may see appearances, but then we may see the light dispelling the darkness. We say, oh, that's a great event. There's a release happening. No, this event is inherently self-released in the now. An unreleased event is impossible. An unreleased event is impossible. An unreleased event is impossible. Okay. Don't struggle, don't analyze, don't try, don't meditate, don't believe, don't repress. Don't analyze, don't seek, don't try, full stop in the now. An unreleased event is impossible. Now, for sure I know what he's pointing to and the importance of it, having gone through this life here and suffered terribly from feeling that the apex of spiritual dualism is somehow the one that is supposed to be liberating us from delusion, where it's really enslaving us. It's really enslaving us. It's really saying, look how much better I am than you. Look how much greater I am than you are. And you must worship me and serve me. And I will tell you how to release and liberate and what you need to do to release and liberate it. And the hell of being caught up in that spiritual bureaucracy, really. The discomfort, the fear, you know. So having been through this, I know exactly what he's speaking to. And for sure is what we need to hear. For sure. And all of us actually are caught up in this bureaucracy of spiritual dualism. Ultimately, all bureaucracy comes from spiritual dualism, which is the support of hallucination. The justification of it. It's saying, don't worry. There's something that is making you unhappy with this appearance. No worry, we're going to fix it. We'll fix it. We'll enlighten it. We'll shine it away. We'll, you know, yeah, I am the bright shining light. I am resting freely. I am hanging loose. I am making this, you know, right for you. That's spiritual dualism. An unreleased event is impossible. So all bureaucracy is. So all, no matter what, whether it's claimed as atheist or secular humanist, all of it is spiritual dualism. All of it. Without any exception. Now I'm speaking about the unrepentant bureaucracy. Now, in reversing out of that, getting, you know, on the path of your evaporating your continuity fear, of course, you have some structure. You have momentum in reversing. In reversing out of momentum, you will seem to have momentum. You will seem to have some structure. You will seem to have, quote unquote, institutional, some bureaucracy. All of that is apparent. Like if you're the head of a great monastery, which Longchenpa was, the top monastery in Tibet and in that whole region, you know, renowned as the top place. He was the head of that. Of course there's discipline. Of course you discipline and you work at it. Okay. But that is to get free of the delusion of spiritual duality. It's not to come to a conclusion that somehow momentum is not self-released in the now, that all events, it's impossible for an event, unreleased events are impossible. It's not to have momentum of a conclusion. It is to set aside the notion of momentum altogether. But obviously, when we're in a situation of belief and momentum, we need to back out of it because of the continuity fear. So this is super important. This is what I'm bringing, is the continuity fear, understanding that, and not getting tricked by this sophistry of spiritual dualism that says, oh, well, you're dualistic too, because you have momentum and structure too, so who are you to talk? Well, we're applying that in the mood of repentance towards our continuity fear, which is the only problem we have. It's the only problem we have. We don't have a problem of some unreleased event whatsoever, but we do have a continuity problem. In other words, we're so accustomed to momentum of trying to release events that we need to now reverse out of that momentum. We can't just drop it like that because we're scared. So we refuse to be bullied by the high and mighty spiritual dualists or high up on the corporate ladder of that, as if we're somehow being contradictory or paradoxical. No, not at all, not at all. Continuity fear requires pragmatism, okay? But it's in the mood of repentance. And the proof of that is returning our attention to this true non-dual teaching in humility and emphasizing this. And the fact that Longchenpa teaches like this is lending himself to help us out with this continuity fear is again further support and proof. Okay. You might say all of existence is just a system of bullying, actually. It's a bullyment. It is a bullyment, really. If that's a word, if we'll just use it, it's a bullyment from the very beginning. We're bullying ourselves into thinking that the answer is to release something, which inherently denies that it's already self-released in the pure spaciousness of now. An unreleased event is impossible. You see, it's a clear-cut, absolute denial of reality, the nature of reality. So we know we have to be taking the stance of hallucination. Did I feel Longchenpa wanted to be worshipped? No. Did I feel he wanted to sit on some asana, some hot raised dais, you know, seat and with all the pomp and say, hey, I'm a guru, look at me, I'm hanging loosely here? No. Not the slightest. I didn't get the slightest feel of that whatsoever. Does he want to have a bunch of mala beads, long hair, sit naked on a throne? Say, look at me, look how released I am. No. Not the slightest, slightest, slightest indication of that. There was no demands at all. So this is what caught my attention. This is, I just called for help and he appeared. And he says, okay, you called for help. I'm here. But at the same time, aware of the compassionate capability to help. There's awareness. It wasn't like he's a stone or something. No, no. It's not putting on an act of hanging loosely. Hanging loosely is released in the now, liberated by the absence of anything to relax. Resting freely is released in the now, liberated by the absence of anything brought to rest. So he's not saying, hey, I brought everything to rest. Look how loosely I'm hanging. Nah, not at all. Not at all. And so I noticed, I said, wow, you seem like enlightened, but where's the hanging loosely? And relaxed. I'm totally relaxed. I'm totally hanging loosely. You know, where's it? No. There's an absence of anything brought to rest. And yet not denying that he's here to help, too, at the same time. Not denying that. He's not trying to put on an act like, hey, everything is self-released, so there's nothing for me to do. Because compassion, inherently, the inherent self-sprung awareness of the now is also sees clearly everything. So there's an inherent intelligence in this absolute clarity. And so that inherent intelligence knows that we have this continuity problem based on our stance of hallucinating, wanting to be the author of creation instead of God. And so it does not force anything, because it knows everything is already, an unreleased event is impossible. But when we ask for help, the intelligence does respond to that, does respond. This is called the grace of God, the grace of God. So I don't want to get all maudlin about it and sentimental about it, you know. It's a great thing, for sure. But the whole purpose of it is just to pay attention to the clarity, you see. Pure clarity. This channel, I put the name pure clarity. This is, we are getting transmissions from pure clarity. Transmissions show up as phase one, the transmissions show up as phase two, transmissions show up as phase three, transmissions show up as phase four. I use the Bible, phase one, Course in Miracles, phase two, Journey Beyond Words, phase three, and Longchenpa's treasury, precious treasury, Longchenpa's precious treasury of the Dharma Dhatu, which means, what does it mean, the sphere of reality. Sphere of reality. Dot two. I think a sphere of Dharma is the one reality. The sphere of the one reality. So Longchenpa's precious treasury of the sphere of the one, of the essence of the one reality. Phase four. Now there was a problem previously in the world, where the high tradition of this somehow was filtering through to the West and filtering out of Tibet. Tibet got dispersed by China and was it 1954, 5, maybe 1950, something like that. I think it was a year before I was born, something like that. Very interesting. The year before I was born, or the year or two before I was born, the Chinese came in and started kicking out, you know, the Tibetans from Tibet, so they had to relocate to India. And in doing so, there began to be this sort of transmission that the Westerners had more access to these teachings. Before, it was difficult to get into Tibet, very difficult. And now, being dispersed throughout, and a lot of Tibetans came to the United States, so it really began to be dispersed, these teachings. Various very high teachings. This was a culture of essentially a monastic culture in Tibet. All right, very intense, both with truth and with spiritual dualism also. Okay, they're both very intense there. And this got dispersed throughout the world gradually. And as this happened, coming to the West, we weren't ready for it, really. Or you might say it put a tremendous challenge upon us, is another way to put it. So I see it as a very positive thing because it's supremely challenging. Now, it has made my life a hell, but a very great opportunity. It's brutal, for sure. But, you know, brutal labor that pays off. I save a lot of time, a delay, for sure. So you look at it as half full or half empty, you know. When the life, I say, well, it's half full or half empty, ultimately. It's half full, ultimately. But it also feels like half empty because it's been so difficult. But what happened was, we weren't ready. We didn't have the context for this teaching. We didn't have the context. And the teachers that came over here were not necessarily, you know, as they wanted to help, we wanted help, they wanted to help. But our lack of context and their lack of true clarity, like a Longchenpa, this was a mix. This got mixed together. And this caused trouble. And difficulties and challenges. And so what happened was, as the Tibetans were being dispersed and this dispersion began to filter throughout the world, and this very high non-dualistic teaching, at least echoes of it, right? I mean, pieces echoes of the vibe. There's a vibe that came out of Tibet, permeated the world, combined with a high vibe of like a Ramana Maharshi, Anandamayi Ma, etc., and other Indian realizers. A Course in Miracles was in the works and began being transmitted to Helen Schuckman in, what was it, like mid-60s. Began to be actually put into a form that could be read by people, I think, in 1974, August, late 74. It was actually published to the public in 76. Or at least it began just in a booklet, photocopied form in 76, something like that. Or maybe it's actually published in 76. This was a phase two that began to give us the context for all this very high phase four teaching that was coming out of Tibet. Then Journey Beyond Words was in 1994, which enabled us to really get up to speed. Okay, and I spent, you know, 20 years with both Phase 2 and Phase 3, ultimately 36 years actually. And then this made it capable, made it possible to now have the right context for this really high Phase 4 teachings. Now, let me see when this book was published. 2013. Okay, Keith Dauman, Vajra Books, Nepal. This book was published in 2013. Very interesting. Which means that the West, now there is some context, enough context. Those of us who have gone through phase 1, 2, and 3 are now able to put this in context, phase 4. We're able to handle these teachings and not get tricked by these declare a spiritual dualness. And God knows we've had a few that really put the pressure on.